I'm listening to jazz. I mean, I'm talking to you, but I have no idea what I'm saying because I'm listening to jazz. I could be talking total nonsense to you right now, you know, like sentences with zip codes in place of the verbs, or the names of Academy Award winners spelled backwards, or the Bill of Rights with the phrase antimicrobial bathroom cleanser inserted after every few words. I have no idea what I'm saying because I am listening to jazz. And don't even ask me who in particular I'm listening to, because I don't know. As far as I'm concerned, it's all one guy. Yeah, that's right. One guy has recorded all the jazz throughout history. I mean, he's a really old guy, of course, having recorded all the jazz and everything, and he must be really tired, having played all the instruments and done all the singing, and I'm sure that the big band era was really tough for him. But it all comes from him. A guy named Jazz. Arthur Jazz. Or Emmett Jazz or Osgood Jazz. I'm not really sure what his first name is, but his last name is definitely Jazz. Yeah, that's who I'm listening to. A guy named Jazz. A cat named Jazz. And he's an eloquent orator, Mr. Jazz is. And I don't listen to anyone else. And you would be best to listen to him, too. And you know why? Well, you know all that other music? Like funk, and punk, and grunge, and electronica, and rockabilly, and salsa, and reggae, and soul, and gospel, and Irish folk, and Delta blues, and Chicago blues, and overproduced mainstream country and western? Well, all that other music is done by a bunch of different people. Sometimes 5 or 6 people at a time! Not jazz. You see, all jazz is done by one guy. Calvin Jazz. Or Preston Jazz, or Leslie Jazz, or whatever his name is. All I know is that this Mr. Jazz person rocks.
Legal disclaimer, use of this product may cause death or death-like symptoms. This product contains chemicals which are known to cause death or death-like symptoms in laboratory animals. Discontinue use of this product if death or death-like symptoms occur. Consult a physician if death or death-like symptoms continue for more than 2 weeks after discontinuing use of this product. The manufacturers of this product cannot be held responsible for any death or death-like symptoms that may result from the use of this product because congressional Republicans, through legislation, have been chipping away at our legal system's ability to seek redress for individuals who have been harmed by products manufactured by or practiced by huge corporations, because Republicans are more concerned with the profitability of huge corporations than they are with the health and safety of you and me. Legal disclaimer, voting for Republicans may cause death or death-like symptoms. I'm afraid that you're going to discover that I've never eaten a salad, and that I've never filed a tax return, and that I once owned a Dan Fogelberg album, and that it took me 25 years to read Atlas Shrugged, and that I went to my senior prom with a hooker who charged me double, and that my ass was once kicked by an Olsen twin, although I'm not sure which one, I think it might have been Ashley, and that I once tried to mass produce a bumper sticker that said, "Suck my Cheney," and that when I do a juice fast, I count pizza as juice, and that since my apartment is smaller than the trunk of my car, I sometimes sleep in the trunk of my car, and that my penis is so small, it's an innie, and that all white people look alike to me, and that my favorite Marx brother was Margaret Dumont, and that Christopher Marlowe wrote all of my plays, and that in a real life Lord of the Flies situation, I would have been Piggy. But mostly I'm afraid that you're going to discover that I don't know what I'm doing.
Whoa, whoa,
whoa. All right. I'm all hopped up. looking at the world from the vantage point of a permanent fetal position, through the haze of an ongoing existential tantrum, catching glimpses of a worshiper of glib deities, an impersonator of inanimate objects, a cutter with a dull blade, the lethargic dignity of an arrogant snowflake, the telegenic outrage of a waiter who has switched jobs with a gynecologist, the accidental passion of a belching, swollen poet bouncing off the walls of a book-lined asylum, and the panic attacks of a slacker wannabe whose fantasy mirror reflects laid-back nihilism and a reflexive suspicion of anyone sending out their thoughts and prayers amidst gratuitous displays of superficial depth and repeated suggestions to man up, while the ongoing battle rages between the sonic opiate and the concise chaos of the moment, and my therapist informs me that insane is the new sane as he combs his hair with a laser and sends me home for another round of cryptic small talk with a perpetual puppy, a meal of grass-fed ambiguity, and the endless recharging of devices. Night falls. Books cry. Unions die of loneliness. And I think again about buying that drone that I saw on Amazon for those days when you just want to urinate on a rainbow. Thank you. Recently, I was forced to give up smoking at gunpoint, which is a real shame because I really liked smoking at gunpoint. Recently, I decided to become a vegetarian because of this one time recently when I was eating a burger and I bit into a hoof. And this other time recently when I was eating a hot dog and I bit into a phone book. Recently, it occurred to me that if 40 is the new 30, then 10 must be the new birth. And isn't labor painful enough already? Recently, I learned that 70% of the human body is composed of water, and I began wondering why we don't slosh more when we walk around, since with all of that water inside of us, you'd think that we'd be splashing and spilling and leaving little trails everywhere we walk, and forming puddles every time we sit down, and getting a shock when we touch something electrical, and I can't understand why there aren't more hairdryer-related deaths. Recently, I came to the conclusion that most people who claim to be Christian wouldn't know Jesus Christ if Jesus Christ bit them on the ass. And recently, also, while rereading the Bible, I discovered that Jesus was a biter. But then, recently, I ran into God in a cockfight, and he told me that the Old Testament is utter bullshit, and that he didn't say or do any of the things in it that are attributed to him, and that his lawyers are preparing a massive lawsuit, and that it sucks to be God anyway, because he can't ever win an argument, not even with his own wife, like when she asks him to take out the trash, and he tells her that he can't because he's busy answering prayers, and she tells him that she prayed that he would take out the trash. So recently I learned that it even sucks to be God, so I feel better. Thank you. I'm afraid that you're going to discover that I've never eaten a salad, and that I've never filed a tax return, and that I once owned a Dan Fogelberg album, and that it took me 25 years to read Atlas Shrugged, and that I went to my senior prom with a hooker who charged me double, and that my ass was once kicked by an Olsen twin, although I'm not sure which one, I think it might have been Ashley, and that I once tried to mass produce a bumper sticker that said, "Suck my Cheney," and that when I do a juice fast, I count pizza as juice, and that since my apartment is smaller than the trunk of my car, I sometimes sleep in the trunk of my car, and that my penis is so small, it's an innie, and that all white people look alike to me, and that my favorite Marx brother was Margaret Dumont, and that Christopher Marlowe wrote all of my plays, and that in a real life Lord of the Flies situation, I would have been Piggy. But mostly I'm afraid that you're going to discover that I don't know what I'm doing. Thank you. You okay, Buford?
Yeah, I'm great. Tired? I think so. Okay. It looks good.
Thank you. Sylvain. Take the iPod out of your ears. Flush the Valium down the toilet. Quit reading the Bible on the BART. Don't use religion as a form of methadone. Tear down that shrine to the Beatles. Remind yourself daily that football is evil. Give the money that you're going to spend on lottery tickets to Ralph Nader. Don't laugh at Greenpeace. Look up the word terrorist in a dictionary before you use it again. Yeah. Think for yourself and at least one other person. Stop pretending that you don't watch TV. When you see a celebrity, instead of an autograph, ask for money.
Yeah, baby.
Only rob young, healthy people. Treat the people who go to tanning salons like the vain, superficial, skin cancer-ridden freaks that they are. Don't feed LSD to puppies. Remind yourself daily that caffeine is evil. Avoid asking stupid questions like, why don't alcoholics just stop drinking? Rock out constantly, but don't talk about it. Look up the word progressive in a dictionary before you use it again. Be nice to cops until you can get close enough to one of their guns. After masturbating, be sure to call yourself the next day. If you get the chance, spit on Rupert Murdoch. Give it up for teachers. Be nice to cab drivers. Tip your waitress. Turn the lights out when you leave. And most important of all, never, ever touch me. I'm all hopped up on indecision, looking at the world from the vantage point of a permanent fetal position, through the haze of an ongoing existential tantrum, catching glimpses of a worshiper of glib deities, an impersonator of inanimate objects, a cutter with a dull blade, the lethargic dignity of an arrogant snowflake, the telegenic outrage of a waiter who has switched jobs with a gynecologist, the accidental passion of a belching, swollen poet bouncing off the walls of a book-lined asylum, and the panic attacks of a slacker wannabe whose fantasy mirror reflects laid-back nihilism and a reflexive suspicion of anyone sending out their thoughts and prayers amidst gratuitous displays of superficial depth and repeated suggestions to man up, while the ongoing battle rages between the sonic opiate and the concise chaos of the moment, and my therapist informs me that insane is the new sane as he combs his hair with a laser and sends me home for another round of cryptic small talk with a perpetual puppy, a meal of grass-fed ambiguity, and the endless recharging of devices. Night falls, books cry, unions die of loneliness. And I think again about buying that drone that I saw on Amazon for those days when you just want to urinate on a rainbow. Thank you. Recently, I was forced to give up smoking at gunpoint, which is a real shame because I really liked smoking at gunpoint. Recently, I decided to become a vegetarian because of this one time recently when I was eating a burger and I bit into a hoof. And this other time recently when I was eating a hot dog and I bit into a phone book. Recently, it occurred to me that if 40 is the new 30, then 10 must be the new birth. And isn't labor painful enough already? Recently, I learned that 70% of the human body is composed of water, and I began wondering why we don't slosh more when we walk around, since with all of that water inside of us, you'd think that we'd be splashing and spilling and leaving little trails everywhere we walk and forming puddles every time we sit down and getting a shock when we touch something electrical, and I can't understand why there aren't more hairdryer-related deaths. Recently, I came to the conclusion that most people who claim to be Christian wouldn't know Jesus Christ if Jesus Christ bit them on the ass. And recently, also, while rereading the Bible, I discovered that Jesus was a biter. But then, recently, I ran into God in a cockfight, and he told me that the Old Testament is utter bullshit, and that he didn't say or do any of the things in it that are attributed to him, and that his lawyers are preparing a massive lawsuit, and that it sucks to be God anyway, because he can't ever win an argument, not even with his own wife. Like when she asks him to take out the trash, and he tells her that he can't because he's busy answering prayers, and she tells him that she prayed that he would take out the trash. So recently I learned that it even sucks to be God. So I feel better. Thank you. Is that a gun? Are you mugging me? Is this a mugging? Okay, I've heard of this. I'm being mugged. You want all of my money, right? Do you take checks? No, of course you don't. I'm sorry. I'm new at this. I've never been mugged before. I'm a crime victim virgin.
Oh, you're sorry. You're only mugging me because you're on drugs. You need money to buy drugs, and that's your excuse for mugging me. Well, I'll let you in on a little secret. I'm on drugs, too. In fact, I'm stoned and drunk right now. In fact, if I wasn't so stoned and drunk right now, I could have opened the front door of my apartment building and gotten inside before you even had the chance to mug me. The only reason you're even able to mug me is because I'm so stoned and drunk right now. In fact, if I wasn't so stoned and drunk right now, I would just reach out with my left hand and grab your gun while using my right hand to push you down the stairs. And then you would be lying in a crumpled heap at the bottom of the stairs while I went inside and called the police, who would come and scoop you up and take you away as the media descended upon my street, wanting to learn the story of the citizen who refused to be a victim and who acted out the fantasy of every citizen who has ever been violated by a street thug. I would attain the stature of a national figure, a symbol of all that is right in Rush Limbaugh's America. Books would be written about me, TV movies would tell my story, and bumper stickers with phrases like, "Don't harass Alan Harris," would adorn cars. But because I'm so stoned and drunk right now, none of that is going to happen. So spare me your lame excuses. Just take my money and my dignity and my innocence and my sense of security and my sense of well-being and my belief in the basic goodness of all people and in a just and balanced universe and fuck off. Besides, we both know that drugs aren't really an excuse. They're a symptom. Class warfare, institutional racism, a society plagued by rampant materialism, a media that lies, and corruption eating away at every level of our government have conspired to force you to mug me. America stole my $18. Not you, but thanks for listening, Mr. Mugger, and have a good night. Thank you.
I am the witness to the filling up of an empty space by an air bubble-wielding casualty whose desire to simply be seen is ignored by the spiritually atonal self-appointed surrogates of the Founding Fathers who are engaged in a tube-induced competition to see which one of them can claim to love Jesus the most while acting the least like him. Their increasingly shrill cries of earthly exceptionalism and promises to invade the sun on day one, giving the pro-oblivion hordes a reason to nod in agreement, chuckle at the punchlines of the damned, and thank God every day for the existence of charlatans whose favorite adjective is apocalyptic, and whose idea of a perfect world includes cops who work on commission, fossil fuels which, when burned, make the air smell like cookies, and the kind of patriotism best expressed through the drunken obliteration of a squirrel with an assault rifle while wearing a bikini. A world of compressed objection and selective rationality in which, if your name happens to be Mr. Pre-Existing Condition, then you are fucked. And when the purges come, fueled by false equivalency, evil subjectivity, and wave after wave of shell-shocked optimism, you will be left with nothing but the knowledge that corporations are sociopaths, that with a frontal lobe comes responsibility, and that just because you're paranoid, that doesn't mean that people aren't voting for Republicans.
You're about to hear Alan Harris, and Alan Harris is a poet, and he's going to come up here and be Alan Harris. Yeah, who else could he be? Who else could he possibly be?
Nobody could do Alan Harris.
I know. Well, actually, there's somebody who, you know, he paid enough and, you know. No, sorry.
If you were going to say that, I would.
I know. I figured I should get that in there. All right, so here's the deal. I first heard him, and I laughed. I'm a tough audience. Now, I can make people laugh and do things like that and have people share laughter with me and I can get it rolling. But very rarely will someone get me into the chuckle zone or the laughing zone. And Alan Harris does that. He has a voice, mannerisms. It could be because he's from New York City originally. Is that correct?
That is correct, sir.
I'm moving around so he can just, you know, kind of goofy up. It could be partially that that is the case. It could be partially that he has an intelligence that goes beyond the norm, so far beyond the norm that he doesn't even know it. And all of his life he probably suffered because of that. Creativity is like that. The man is creative. He's wild. He's crazy. He's a genius. He has smarts. He has humor. He has panache. And other things, which you're about to find out. But he will keep his clothes on, just so you know. All right, so bring up Alan Harris here with a loud, rough, raucous, come on.
My bicycle mocks me. My TV likes to watch. My electrical outlets won't keep their opinions to themselves. My Venetian blinds think they're all that. My stereo has a God complex. My speakers aren't talking to each other. My CDs want their own room. My DVDs can't stop sneezing. My closet has a drinking problem. My desk just has issues. My mirror keeps looking at me. My air conditioner voted twice in the last presidential election. My rug is in a cult. My lamps could lose a little weight. My handgun has low self-esteem. My smoke detector is delusional. My nightstand is going rogue. My bed sleeps around. My pillows are definitely on drugs. My comforter is selling drugs to my pillows. My bookcase is thinking of leaving the priesthood. My radiator sees conspiracies in everything. My ceiling won't take anything seriously. My walls deserve better. Thank you for that wonderful introduction. It's great to be here at my spiritual home, sacred grounds, where I worship the deity that is Dan Brady.
I bow down. Oh, him, not you.
Oh, sorry.
I am bowing. I dwell in the lower echelons of the human experience, an honorary eunuch who has daily disagreements with reality and who can't shake the feeling that he should go to more funerals, a coward with a bad temper, forming tentative relationships with very old souls who spend their days giggling into a void, sometimes scarily upbeat, sometimes acceptably detached, sometimes contentiously agreeable. I want only to swim in a vertical ocean and to unionize all of the losers. Instead, I plunge headlong into the nightmarish minutiae of sanctimonious traffic jams, holy day ruthlessness, exuberantly Pavlovian stick figures, and smirking millionaires who brag about how the only two organizations they belong to are their church and the NRA. I race past the shit-colored street signs and down the roadkill-infested highways of America, marveling at the folksy bumper sticker wisdom of phrases like, "Guns make people more polite," and "I will not dial 911, and "save a cow, eat a vegetarian." Stopping for sustenance at well-scrubbed strip malls filled with neo-Puritans who were all jacked up on right-wing pornography and to whom I could feel slightly superior because at least my porn is fact-based. Awash in coverage of Watergate and Bridgegate and Russiagate and abuse of the filibuster gate and voter suppression gate and climate change denial gate and income inequality gate and religious hypocrisy gate and not letting the first African-American president appoint a Supreme Court justice gate and hopefully someday a scandal involving a gate so that it can be called Gate, because I think that that would be really funny. And cheerful pessimism is just about all that I have left. Relatively new. I tend to write lists. I write a lot of things that are in the form of a list, and this is definitely that. My ears are ringing, my eyes are bulging, my spine is tingling, my sides are splitting, my pulse is pounding, my heart is racing, my guts are wrenching, my loins are girding, my brain is reeling, my mind is blown. My lungs are spritzing, my bones are cavorting, my kidneys are careening, my joints are procrastinating, my muscles are obfuscating, my lymph nodes are colluding, my white blood cells are binge watching, my red blood cells are channel surfing, my liver is swing dancing, my immune system is mugging for the camera, and it's only 9 a.m. This is something that I wrote about 20 years ago, and I don't read it too often because it's kind of a downer. But so enjoy. When people die, almost all of them go to hell because heaven's standards are just too high and almost no one can meet them. So hell is packed. It's wall-to-wall people, like a Saturday night at a Red Lobster. Well, heaven, on the other hand, is completely empty, except for a few souls. Abraham Lincoln, Mother Teresa, Joey Ramone. But now there's one more. A little old lady who was miserable on earth. So God took her out and brought her up to heaven, where she's still miserable. Complains all the time. It's too cloudy. You can't smoke anywhere. Who's this Joey Ramone person? He smells. And it all started when a paramedic called it at 6:03 a.m. on an otherwise sedate Monday morning. By 6:05, greed and hypocrisy had begun leaking from fissures in the earth. Cars were kidnapped, money became a constitutional right, heartbeat futures plummeted, centers of attention shifted, sympathetic Amway vultures puked, would-be corporate moguls got their scripture fix, nostalgia got a MasterCard in the mail. Mucus coughed up a smoker. Superstardom broke a tooth. A pulse checked itself. Cats beat the crap out of dogs. Sex lost a game of chicken. And a subway crashed into the sun. Soon a deadhead was flashing a peace sign and barking orders. And everything was set for an open mic funeral, where a gray beard dropped a yarmulke bombshell. A microwave oven broke into tears. Line dancers juggled damaged kidneys, and I ran through the temple screaming, "Save the planet! Grieve less! Recycle more! Grief is for suckers!" But no one got it. So I fulfilled my sticky gravesite obligations, and then an old friend came along and supplied oblivion. I found myself in a haze of freeway memories, where billboards proclaimed, "Lies don't die." Frozen food raised me. And apparently Hitler just needed a hug. I passed through some dysfunctional girlfriend meeting places and wound up in a cul-de-sac where ambiguity lingered, art and nonsense were making out, and punctuation was terminal. It was a place of generational epiphanies, extraterrestrial futons, and quiet time for the lower middle class. A place where death only happened to other people and where I was the little old lady's illogical favorite. Finally, I crawled inside of one of my empty pockets and slept for a while. When I woke up, I vowed that I would stop pretending that my bong was an apartment. And up in heaven, the little old lady, for the first time in her life, or afterlife, was smiling. About 10 minutes, okay. Speaking of God, I have a very left-wing view of God. I like to think that God is a weed-smoking, union-loving, public education-friendly, sex education-advocating, non-gun-owning, pro-choice, anti-animal testing, socialistic, cross-dressing, vegan, bisexual feminist who digs Karl Marx, Friedrich Nietzsche, William Burroughs, Lenny Bruce, Robert Mapplethorpe, early Rolling Stones, John Lennon's Imagine, Monty Python's Life of Brian, and the delicious irony at the end of each episode of The Twilight Zone. And who wishes that people would stop thanking him or her when they win awards because he or she doesn't give a damn who wins Oscars, Emmys, Grammys, SAG Awards, Source Awards, CMA Awards, and especially People's Choice Awards. And who doesn't get the popularity of pseudo-messianic, uber-materialistic, racist, warmongering, asshole TV and radio talk show hosts who are most definitely and quite obviously going to hell. And who doesn't care what you call him or her, as long as you don't shoot at or try to blow up people who call him or her something different. and who would consider it a personal favor, please and thank you, if organized religions were a little less organized around ridiculous rituals like the smearing of ashes across foreheads, and a little more concerned with the practicality of giving tangible help to those who need it, like it says to do in that unreadable book that they claim to love so much. Oh. And who would like it very much if people who are lucky enough to have the right to vote would take that vote seriously enough to not base it on their fears and prejudices and a warped interpretation of the archaic language found in documents that are hundreds of years old. And to not vote for someone who claims that God told him to run. Because no one who my God wants to see in office would brag about it. And that's because my God is an atheist. Oh, my God. God bless you, Dad.
Oh, thank you.
Well, nobody else would.
I was going to say that, but I passed it up on the phone.
I love this man.
Yeah,
I love this man.
I didn't mop the corn either. So.
You know that his Indian name is Crouches at Microphone.
No,
you better continue, Alan.
Just get
on with it.
I've lost control of
right.
Don't let us get started.
You've got the bumbling.
Don't get me wrong. The voices in my head mean well. But the truth is, I would kill to be normal. Rather than sipping from the proverbial lysergic juice box, I would rather be a member of the smirk demographic. An eloquently robotic purveyor of phony authenticity, hyperactively interactive, indirectly misdirected, working for nothing more than a chance to spend my incredible shrinking weekend guzzling deep-fried beer while watching violently masturbatory and or homoerotic sporting events on the tube. But unfortunately, I'm too busy aging ironically, beating up trees, trying to avoid friends I've never met, fashioning a persona out of charming dissonance and edgy wholesomeness, all the while haunted by the image of the homeless man standing on a street corner holding up a crudely lettered sign that says, Between Two Worlds. And the bumper sticker that demands, Honk if you don't exist. And what if I don't exist because I'm between two worlds? That would actually explain a lot. Like the fear I live with that I'm a figment of someone else's imagination. And the other fear I live with that I'm a random genetic mutation. And the other fear I live with that I'm becoming a sedimentary layer. And the other fear I live with that I'm just killing time until time kills me. And the other fear I live with that the Beach Boys might record another album. I'm like a blind person who's afraid of the dark. Fist bumps make me nervous. The phrase nothing burger sends me into a fit of uncontrollable rage. I have self-esteem issues because I don't live in a swing state. And I'm obsessed with finding the answers to life's big questions, like, can a sock feel pain? Are all compliments lies? Is a cursory like on Facebook the new pity fuck? And when I talk to myself, should I answer?
Yeah. Yes.
Thank you.
Don't pay attention to this. This is wrong. That's wrong.
Oh, is that why it's there?
Yeah, that's wrong.
Okay, gotcha. Okay, very quickly, about 30 years ago, I was in an improv class, and we were given this technique where you had to in order to free your mind, where you would set a timer for 15 minutes, and then you would write for that amount of time, nonstop, whatever you came out of your head, and 30 years later, I decided to try to apply that technique to writing poetry, and the first subject that I wrote about was the technique itself, and this is the result of that. I'm trying an experiment. I'm setting the timer on my iPhone for 15 minutes and then writing nonstop for that amount of time. Just keep writing. Never take the pen off the page. Just keep writing. Even if I can't think of anything to write, just keep writing. Even if I just keep writing the phrase, just keep writing over and over again. Boy, will that make a great poem. All work and no play makes Alan a dull boy. No, wait, that's been done. Just keep writing. Let whatever is in my head just spill out onto the page. Wait a minute, are you kidding? I mean, are you sure about this? Do you have any idea what is in there? Are you at all aware of the sick and twisted shit that is contained within the receptacle known as Alan's mind? The depraved ideas that would make the thoughts of Charles Manson's head seem like a letter from the Pope? Do you really want those cerebral etchings from the psyche of a madman to be let loose? This was a terrible idea. I could be unleashing forces that might very well change the world in horrible and irrevocable ways. I need to stop this. I need to put the depraved cork back in the bottle. I need to put the sick and twisted toothpaste back into the tube. I need to shut, lock, and board up the door to my mind. Go back to writing the kind of glib nonsense that people will forget about 2 minutes after I've read it to them. Fear, inhibitions, short attention span, all the things that keep me psychologically constipated are there for a reason. Let others create true and lasting art by tapping into the deepest, darkest recesses of their minds, by plumbing the depths of their subconscious, by burrowing down until they find themselves face to face with the core of their very being. I need to just write my little jokes, make my superficial observations, do whatever it takes to keep the living, breathing, shaking, squirming, flexing, preening, pulsating, gyrating, pogoing, jitterbugging, jack-jumping, show-stopping evil within me from ever seeing the light of day. Put down the pen. Put down the pen! Drop the pen! Drop the pen! Just stop writing! Thank you. Thank you. These are some of the forces that I've unleashed. Each day is like a machine in which sometimes, but not too often, the gears mesh smoothly, while most other times they grind and smoke and screech. And there's one part of me that just stands there, masochistically waiting as the pieces fly off in all directions, hurtling through time and space, on their way to taking out one of my eyes or splitting my nose in two, while another part of me fights back with casual aggression and formulaic edginess against the idea that I'm trapped in a mindfuck of my own making, in which patterns start forgetting things, a U-turn makes a U-turn on a one-way street, the promises of a distinctly American ego keep getting broken, the fine line between everything and nothing disappears completely, and I win a staring contest with a corpse. Luckily, technology saves my mind's ass, as my Mac, iPhone, and iPad all alert me to the fact that you're interested in going to an event near me tomorrow, in which birds and insects are going to try to teach people how to fly, but only after they've signed one hell of a waiver. And as I sit high up in imaginary bleachers, watching through binoculars as one idiotic sack of humanity after another hits the ground with a delightfully messy splat, it occurs to me that I'm not going to miss the annoyingly wholesome, or the notoriously mellow, or those who are sociopath adjacent, or people so boring that even schizophrenia wouldn't make them interesting. Something, by the way, I could never be accused of, because like me or loathe me, I'm fucking interesting. I'm a sometime hater of love. A crosser of lines, a trafficker in petulance, a schadenfreude wholesaler, an accidental deconstructionist. I'm a vegetarian who won't eat his vegetables. I'm the wearer of a tuxedo on casual Friday. I'm polarized and proud of it. I'm like the wind, only shorter. Thank you very much. This will be my last piece. You've been terrific, far more than I deserve.
Oh, Al.
Did I pull that off, or
no? No. What'd you say?
I knew he doesn't listen. I knew he as soon as he introduces the poet, he sits down and just sucks. Oh, good God, yes. By all means, I'm so glad we're on the same page. I would rather die than not see eye to eye with you on this. Never in a million years would I have thought it was possible for someone to be so right about something. My whole life has been leading up to this one act of harmony. I can't remember what life was like before this concurrence. A whole new world of, oh yeah, has opened up before me. Agreeing with you is better than sex. I'm basking in the sweet, sweet glow of your accuracy. I weep for those who can't appreciate how perfectly formed are the ideas that you have used to support your position on this subject. Has there ever in the history of the world been someone who has been so spot on about something. Hey, stop being so correct. You're scaring me. I feel so inadequate next to your lack of error. I'm actually losing body mass, being in such close proximity to your field of exactitude. I am mercilessly taunted by the vastness of the distance between you and anything that bears even the slightest resemblance to something that might be mistaken for a miscalculation. The success of your systematic voraciousness has led me to come to the inescapable conclusion that, by comparison, my whole life is a large vat of nothingness and uselessness nestled along the bottom of a large steaming crater that now stands in place of what was once my existence. Who the hell do you think you are, arrogantly flaunting your faultless logic, your unimpeachable argumentation, your irreproachable dialectic? You can take your sound judgment and your unassailable train of thought and shove them right up the meticulousness of your precision-laden ass! Thank you very much. People tell me that I'm too cerebral, that I think too much. But here's a thought. You wouldn't say that to Einstein. Like, Einstein, lighten up. You think too much. E equals M. That's enough? No, of course not. Because it's not possible to think too much. Thinking is what defines us as people and sets us apart from the hamster and the bunny rabbit and the aardvark and the possum and the platypus and the caribou and the panda bear and the koala bear and the howler monkey and the African spider monkey. And how can you do too much of something that does that? But, here's a thought. You wouldn't say to a dog, "Dog, you lick your own crotch too much." No, of course not, because that's how dogs define themselves. They lick their own crotches. And sure, we find it disgusting, but they seem to like it. So, when we think, it's like we're licking our own crotches. And without the ability to think and or lick our own crotches, we would just be vicious, snarling creatures, instinctively lashing out with swift and horrible violence at anyone who threatens us. And sure, there are lots of people in the world like that right now. But here's a thought. Maybe those people are like that because they don't think enough. Wow. Deep thought, huh?
To sign your official documents. He's pet friendly, he's a taxi driver, an amateur film historian whose half-assed attempt at an acting career was such a disaster that he was kicked out and banned for life from four or five of the boroughs of New York City, Staten Island being the exception. He was attracted to the artistic freedom of spoken word, and it has been his main creative outlet for several decades. Being involved in the poetry scenes of New York, Los Angeles, San Francisco, although he likes San Francisco because the people here smell nicer and it's where the word party is. Please put your hands together for Alan.
Self-promotion. Take the iPod out of your ears, flush the Valium down the toilet, quit reading the Bible on the BART, don't use religion as a form of methadone, tear down that shrine to the Beatles, remind yourself daily that football is evil. Look up the word terrorist in a dictionary before you use it again. Think for yourself and at least one other person. Stop pretending that you don't watch television. When you see a celebrity, instead of an autograph, ask for money. Treat the people who go to tanning salons like the vain, superficial, skin cancer-ridden freaks that they are. Don't feed LSD to puppies. Remind yourself daily that caffeine is evil. Avoid asking stupid questions like, why don't alcoholics just stop drinking? Look up the word progressive in a dictionary before you use it again. Be nice to cops until you can get close enough to one of their guns. After masturbating, be sure to call yourself the next day. If you get the chance, spit on Mike Pence. Give it up for teachers. Be nice to cab drivers. Tip your waitress. Turn the lights out when you leave. And most important of all, never, ever touch me. You know, every feature, every poet pretty much who comes up here says that same thing about how great is this band? Let's give a hand for the band. And, wow. and I was trying to think of some like unique way of saying it, but I can't. They're just so great. And how great are they? Let's give them a hand. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, give it up for Alan Harris upstairs on stage there. Also, give it up one more time for the Word Party. If you guys are here for the 8 p.m. showing of Killing My Lobster's Acting One Showcase show, that house is open. Once again, the 8 p.m. showing of Killing My Lobster's Acting One Showcase, that house is open. So grab a drink and head on into our main stage. It will begin in a couple of minutes. In the meantime, give it up one more time for the Word Party.
A sadness so deep, so profound, bottomless and all-encompassing, of such magnitude and intensity that I am physically ill. Oh yeah, I'm gonna hurl. And I'm gonna hurl with such force and velocity that it will spew forth, travel the length of the room, and it will be vomit that is the result of the sadness that is so intense that the vomit itself will become a person. And as I am now completely paralyzed by this sadness which has overtaken me, then this person, composed entirely of my vomit, will become my vomit alter ego. My vomit doppelganger. And he will take over my life. He will perform my daily routine. He will drive my car. He will work at my job. He will pine for my ex-girlfriends. And he will be better at it than I am, despite his handicap of having an all vomit composition. My friends will love him. My family will respect him. My boss will promote him. My ex-girlfriends will want to date him. He will be charming and fun and graceful. And upchuck Fred Astaire. He will be fearless and sensitive at all the right times. And no one will care that he is a big, disgusting pile of vomit, because he will be perfect in every other way, and he will never. Anyone who wants to steal my identity is welcome to it. It's never done me much good. So, help yourself. Enjoy the calloused psyche and the fog-shrouded priorities and the emotional inconveniences. Enjoy my currency-sniffing fetish and my obsession with claustrophobia as a lifestyle choice. Enjoy my concern over the confusion of trees and how easily I'm intimidated by clouds. Enjoy a metabolism so slow that it would lose a race to a turtle that has just ingested a large amount of quaaludes. Enjoy my belief system, which includes the idea that intolerant people should be put against the wall and shot. Enjoy the unhealthy amount of time that I spend thinking about burritos that I've known, and the fact that I still somehow manage to have bad hair days, even though I no longer have hair. Enjoy the industrial strength envy I experience every day of semi-bearded, energy drink addled, information overdosing, nickname bestowing, tech industry employment seeking, device obsessed, app happy, glibness spouting, tweet spewing pseudo people whose lives are so much better than mine and who live in big houses with tennis courts and swimming pools and a heliport and a paddock room and a time machine and a living mime and diamond studded toilet seats that hurt like hell when you sit on them but make a great status symbol. And enjoy my inability to shake the feeling that there is no afterlife and that we are all just finite, compostable, biological entities that one day, for one reason or another, just cease to function. But, although, on the other hand, you can also enjoy the fondness that I have for winking at satellites and for getting lost in the joy of an unexpected cartwheel and for taking the time to stop and smell the weirdness and for taking the time to thank a vagina for its service and for the time to kernel of hope I possess that there is indeed a place called heaven where the hours may be irregular but the food is always excellent. Thank you. Thank you all. You're a great audience. I'm sorry, I really do mean that. It's hard for me to say such things without sounding good. At night, I curl up next to memories of a smile that you could pay the rent with. And almond-shaped eyes so beautiful that they would have even impressed that Odyssey guy, whose name, by the way, I know is Odysseus, but calling him that Odyssey guy just sounds so much more detached. And detaching oneself from stuff is cool. And referring to anything intellectual or emotional as stuff is another cool form of detachment. And I want to be cool and detached. I want to be self-consciously, ironically, retro. I want to do the air quotes thing every time I take a breath. I want to make jokes about my own death. I want to laugh at you when you insult me. I want to mock you in subtle ways and make you cry. I want to stop pretending that my cowardice is actually actually pacifism while secretly wishing that I was 6 feet two so that I could beat the shit out of every jock that I've ever met. And I want to stop being so uncomfortable in my own skin that I could feel out of place in a room full of clones of myself. Self-conscious about the fact that I was the only one who wasn't a clone. Wary of the one clone who would inevitably appear to try and turn all of the other clones against me by pointing at me and saying, "You see that guy over there? He's real! Isn't that disgusting?" And finally, overwhelmed by the irony that I don't feel real. Not just conventionally abnormal, but profoundly different. On a level so basic that it almost doesn't exist. And which has caused me to sink an enormous amount of money into the engaging of the services of intergalactic private detectives for the purposes of discovering the identity of the extraterrestrial who impregnated my mother and doomed me to a life of difference. In which, while the rest of you are worshiping at the altar of caffeine and putting snuff films on your 10 best lists and smashing each other's heads in because of who did or didn't make it into the playoffs, I'm on the outside looking in, my little face pressed against the window that keeps getting fogged up by my clones and my memories and my detachments. Thank you. I've been told I can do two more. I've only done that here four times, so is that all right? Okay. I'm listening to jazz right now. I mean, I'm talking to you, but I have no idea what I'm saying because I'm listening to jazz. I mean, I could be talking total nonsense to you right now, like sentences with zip codes in place of the verbs, or the names of Academy Award winners spelled backwards, or the Bill of Rights with the phrase antimicrobial bathroom cleanser inserted after every few words. I have no idea what I'm saying because I'm listening to jazz. And don't even ask me who in particular I'm listening to, because I have no idea. As far as I'm concerned, it's all one guy. Yeah, that's right, one guy has recorded all the jazz throughout history. I mean, he's a really old guy, of course, having recorded all the jazz and everything, and must be really tired, having played all the instruments and done all the singing, and I'm sure that the big band era was really tough for him. But it all comes from him, a guy named Jazz, a cat named Jazz. Yeah, that's who I'm listening to right now. And he is an eloquent orator, Mr. Jazz is. And I don't listen to anyone else. And you should listen to him too. And you know why? Well, you know all that other music like funk and punk and grunge and electronica and rockabilly and salsa and reggae and polka and gospel and soul and Irish folk and Delta blues and Chicago blues and overproduced Main Street country and western. Well, all that other music is done by a bunch of different people, sometimes five or six people at a time. But not jazz. You see, all jazz is done by one guy. Leslie Jazz. Or Osgood Jazz. Or Preston Jazz. Or Archie Jazz. Or, yeah, I'm not really sure what his first name is, but his last name is definitely Jazz. Yeah. And this Mr. Jazz person rocks. Thank you. The next time I do a feature here, I'm gonna learn to say that in French. Because I think that, no, I don't know, I've never heard anyone say it in French, so. Does anyone know how to say this band's excellent in French?
Excellent.
Excellent.
Would you like another?
Put your hands together one more time for our incredible feature, Alan Harris.